데피니션 6의 크리스 해커 대표를 자리에 모시겠습니다. 큰 박수 부탁드리겠습니다.
But there's something about the way the games are developed, and I'll talk about some of the characteristics later, that I think this is more applicable to. AAA games are come from a more top-down design methodology, and I think this stuff is probably relevant in the small and small parts of the design process, but it's not gonna, you're not going to have a big effect on AAA games. Luckily, this is an indie game conference, so that's the right audience. So I said top-down. What do I mean by top-down versus bottom-up? So here's my 100% accurate taxonomy of game design methodologies. So first off, there's top-down. This is where you have some idea about what you want to do. And you write design documents and then implement it. And sometimes prototypes and you know that sort of thing. But you basically have this high-level idea of what you're doing, and you kind of fill in all the parts and then begin to implement it. These are obviously idealized. And then there's bottom-up, where you just start programming, basically. Again, this idea of like coming up with a design document versus like having a guy jumping on the screen and typically a button, and then seeing where you go from that small kernel or trying to fill in all the parts from the top. And in reality, most games are designed as a hybrid. You'll iterate, you'll playtest will happen, and if you're doing a more top-down kind of large-scale thing, there'll be a playtest, and then you'll iterate the design based on that. But usually things are filtered in one direction or the other. And I find indie games tend to be more bottom-up in a lot of ways. That kind of reactivity versus a kind of proactive top-down design, that reactivity is kind of important for what I'm talking about, to let what I'm about to talk about happen. So I need to describe Spy Party as a high-level design, and I'm going to do it pretty quickly. It turns out it's going to be on the stage on the 15th sometime during the big stage outside, so you can check it out in real time there. It doesn't matter who, but it's also available now. So, but roughly what the game is an asymmetric competitive game about a cocktail. And so on the one side, one player controls the spy, and the spy is at the cocktail party. And they're doing cocktail party things like you know having drinks or looking at the artwork or flirting with people. Being bored of checking their watch to see if it's time to leave, all sort of normal things you might do at a party. Meanwhile, they're also trying to accomplish spy missions, which are basically tropes from spy and mystery fiction, things like Bug the Ambassador, Contact the Double Agent, those kinds of things. Looking in from outside the party, very upset that they were not invited to the party as the sniper, they do not know who the spy is. All the characters at the party are controlled by the computer, they're NPCs, except for the spy player. The spy character is controlling the player. The sniper is trying to build up a case for finding the spy, looking for tells, looking for different evidence of spy-like behavior, and then eventually they have one bullet with which to choose who the spy is and end the game. If the spy accomplishes their missions, then the spy wins. If the spy runs out of time and doesn't accomplish the mission, the sniper wins. If the sniper shoots a civilian, the spy wins. If the sniper shoots the spy, obviously the sniper wins. So that's basically the high-level idea, the design of Spy Party, kind of the basic mechanic or gimmick. I'm going to go into some specifics about different missions and things and how luck and listening to the game and changing the game play helped shape how the game worked out. But they're all going to fit into this framework, this asymmetric spy versus sniper, having accomplished missions versus having to find a deception versus perception. Kind of game. As I said, you don't have to think Spy Party is a good game design, but I think it's pretty clear that it's a pretty deep game design because my top players have played 20,000 games of it at 3 minutes a pop. So there's a lot of actual data, and I don't just mean data because I never actually look at my analytic metrics type data, but there's a lot of like anecdotal discussion about the game and a really healthy community that talks about mechanics and how they change, and this is going to be part of what I talk about as a characteristic kind of necessary to take advantage of this, is you want to have people playing your game over a long period of time so that they can actually, so you have time for this sort of thing to happen that I'm about to talk about. So that I have, I'm very lucky that I have that in Spy Party. So I just want to say that like the depth of the game, a lot of these things I'm about to talk about play towards the depth of the game. Make the game deeper, they make the game kind of more competitive. They kind of keep what's called the meta going and evolving over time, things like that. So let's talk about one of the mechanics. One of the spy missions, it's a very spy-like thing, is to flirt and seduce a target. There's a person at the PC, controlled by the computer, is your seduction target, and you need to seduce them. And now it's a video game, so you don't actually seduce them in any meaningful way. You basically go talk to them a certain number of times and fill up a bar that at 100% you have successfully seduced them. So it's an abstraction of the kind of modern seduction experience. A lot of missions in Spy Party have what's called an action test, where there's a mission you're trying to accomplish, seducing. And then layered on top of that, to make the game a little deeper, is you might call it a quick time event, or if you've seen Gears of War, Active Reload, it's called an action test. It's a little skill check. I've done an entire talk about the design of this thing, but basically the idea being, one of the themes in Spy Party is this idea of attention as a resource, where you're spending your attention. And so if you want to do well the action test, you have to take your eyes off party for a second and actually focus on this thing. It's randomized in a couple different ways. And so it's got this little white bar is going across the red, green, and white bar. And if you ignore it completely, you get what's called the normal result or the white result. If you hit it in the white zone, you also get that normal result. If you hit the green, you get the good result. And if you hit the red, you get the bad result. And so let's see what this looks like roughly for the seduction mission. So here's a really low frame rate animated GIF. So this guy's seducing the target who has the red triangle over her head. And if you hit the white part of the bar, you talk to them like normal. And you fill up the bar based on how close you are in conversation. And so that's just the normal flirting behavior, and that's what happened before action test we reported the game. I had a meeting later. If you get the green, the animation in this case of this oftentimes the animation will be different, but in the case of flirting, the animation is the same. But if you get the green, you get more bar fill, like you do a better job of flirting, right? Which is what you expect. And then if you get the red, you were somehow so offensive that you actually kick the person out of the conversation. They just leave. You get no credit, and they fail. Which means you have to chase them around the party. So you know, it's suspicious. You not only don't get the flirt that time, but also now you have to actually go find them again, which, you know, getting people in a position where you can flirt is part of the challenge, and you only have 3 or so minutes to accomplish multiple missions. And so time is of the essence for the spot. So it's a pretty big penalty to kick someone to lose an opportunity for a flirt and have them leave. But a strange thing, so this is obviously bad because you're losing time and an opportunity. But a strange thing happened when I put this in and people started playing with it at a competitive level. And that is, they started using it to try and frame the seduction target. So if you think about it, the movement around the party, this etiquette of how people move, how the NPCs move, when things happen, how the party is evolving, all of that stuff the sniper was looking for. In terms of building up a case against someone, they have a mechanic where they can like mark people suspicious or not suspicious as they're playing, so they can kind of use a little bookkeeping mechanic. And it turns out that leaving a conversation at certain times is suspicious for certain reasons that we're not going to go into details of that. But this red action test actually gives the spy opportunity to kick someone out, to make someone leave a conversation under their control, who's not the spy, right? The spy obviously can leave the conversation. But this allows them to kick an NPC out of the conversation on a whim. And this is totally unintended. I thought I was just penalizing. I thought the red action test was just bad. But elite players started using it to frame as part of an overall alternate plan to frame the seduction targets. They would set up a situation where the seduction target was maybe a little more suspicious, kick them out of the conversation at a time when the spy would leave the conversation, and sometimes get the seduction target shot. And so this is an example of a totally unintended design thing that players found and started. I'm going to use the term exploiting, although I'm going to correct for the term later. Another example of this has to do with bug the ambassador. So one of the missions that you accomplish, you have to accomplish as a spy, usually, is bugging the ambassador. By bug, I mean the word bug is a little overloaded in game development, but I mean it in the spy movie sense, like a plant a listening device on someone's person. And so you can do this in a conversation while you're standing next to them, or you can do do while you walk by them. And it involves sticking your arm out to plant the bug. So there's what we call a hard tell. The clue to the sniper is actually an animation. If they spot it, you're toast. But it's a pretty subtle animation. There's a lot of stuff going on at the party. So if you get it by them, then you got away with this mission. Now, the walking version of bugging the ambassador, there's the one in the competition where you're both standing still, and that is just a range-based thing, you're either in range or not. But the walking version of it, you have to start the animation before you actually are in range for the bug to take, for the actual planned listening device. And so you actually have to plan ahead, and it turns out that walking speed is very important for this. If you have a competitive multiplayer game, players tend to, and this is a Wednesday, players tend to analyze everything about it. And so this is a YouTube video that someone uploaded that compared the walking speeds of all the characters. And so it simultaneously starts them all from one end of this venue and they walk towards the other and then it records how long each one takes, right? I don't document any of this, but it's actually fun for players to discover this stuff, kind of like tier lists in fighting games, right? And so it turns out that this character, whose nickname is Pearls, they don't have official names yet, but she's the slowest character of the current set of characters. Because she's got this long sheath dress on, and just to make the animation look good, she can be walking slower than the other characters. So let's discuss how this affects walking modes. If we imagine the ambassador, this is top down, if we imagine the ambassador is this purple dot, and the purple circle is the ring of range around the ambassador where the walking mode has to take place, meaning you can start the animation as soon as you hit the edge of that ring, and you have to be near the ambassador in the middle of the animation for the bug mission to accomplish the bug mission. It's tuned such that the walking speed of most players makes them, if the green is the path of the spy, the walking speed of most players, you have to actually bleed off a little speed and make a little arc around the ambassador. And that makes for a tell that the sniper can spot if they're being very observant, right? So you'll see someone maybe move by the ambassador and maybe turn a little bit in a way that like looks like it's a little intentional, right? And so the game is about building up a case with all of these small little clues. Sometimes you see the animation exactly and you can just shoot the person, but most of the time you're kind of making these big consequential decisions with partial information. You've got a suspicion about who someone is. Well, it turns out with Pearls, because she's so much slower than other characters, she actually doesn't have to arc around the ambassador. And so her, just due to serendipity, her walk speed, which was really an animation thing based on her dress, like just making her look good as an animated character, she can keep walking straight. And the bug animation, the bug timing works out exactly right. Which, slow walking speed is a disadvantage. You've got to get around the venue to actually accomplish missions. But it turns out in this case, for this mission, slow walking speed is an advantage for her. So it starts to balance out her slow walking speed, which was completely meant as both an animation quality thing and as a kind of a downside to this character. And so both of these are a little bit like embracing exploits, both of these examples. These things were designed to be negative, but the mechanic turned out to have unintended positive consequences. And instead, normally, what you might do in these cases is try to patch it out. Try to say, like, okay, well, this is not what I intended, and I'm a designer, and I know exactly what I want my game to be, so now I'm going to try and figure out how to change the code or the animations to fix this problem. And instead, what I'm proposing is that you see these things happen, and you have this open mind where you're in openness to change, and you say, this is actually better than what I intended to do here, and you embrace it. Another kind of category, I'm going to describe some of the complexities around drinks. So all cocktail parties have to have cocktails. And spy parties are no different. And originally, the plan was, and still is, to put in a poison drink machine. So where the spy would have to poison someone's drink at the party. The person would drop dead in the middle of the party, be dragged off by the security guard, and the party would be like, hubbub about this. And that's very spy movie, right? And there's currently no poison drink machine yet, but I needed, in order to make that work, because it's a video game, you have to do everything, I had to put drinks into the game, right? So I had to add the idea of holding things, and the idea of a waiter who goes around and serves drinks, and you have to be able to sip drinks, and of course, if you're holding a drink, now that means you can't do things on the side of the of your body where you're holding a drink. So in this case, this guy's holding a drink with his left hand, so that means he can't bug the ambassador on his left side now. You can't hold statues like you see statues in the background here. bunch of other things you need to hold. It doesn't affect you from, like, say, flirting, but it does affect what you can hold in your hand. And so I got drinks in just mechanically in preparation for doing the Poison the Drink mission, and all of this gameplay happened unintended-wise. So obviously, having a drink is a downside, right? Because that means you only have half the space in which to accomplish missions. Except for that makes, so that means you don't want to have a drink, but that means having a spy have a drink is less suspicious, which starts to balance out the desire to not have a drink. Similarly, now there's a waiter, right? And there's a waiter who moves between players, moves between guests offering them drinks. And you can actually call the waiter over. You can refuse a drink, and you can take a drink. But there also there became all this etiquette associated with how the waiters, how the drink offering, and how often you sip, and all of this, which are all things I just put in to make a plausible drink simulation for a party. All this became etiquette stuff that the that elite level snipers started paying attention to. So timing of when you take drinks, what's the probability that you'll finish your drink now versus later, whether you walk to the bookshelf with a drink in your hand or not, all these things started to become gameplay. Even though the mission that I originally put drinks in is still not implemented, I'm going to do the poison drink mission, but I still haven't even got to it, and all of a sudden there's just a ton of gameplay associated with drinks just being in the game. And then it went even farther, where players started suggesting mission ideas that had to do with the waiter and drinks. So, for example, there are now two missions that have to do with drinks that aren't poison and drink. There's, as you can see on the screen, there's purloining the guest list. That rectangle on the waiter's tray is a thing you can steal. It's like, you know, the fiction is the guest list, and you steal that, and it disappears. It's hard to see it sometimes from the sniper's point of view. And the ambassador leaves fingerprints on drinks. And so you can fingerprint the ambassador using the drink mechanics. Both of these didn't work in my mind when I first started putting drinks in. But because drinks got in and started to have all these etiquette style consequences in terms of the gameplay, how it plays out, they just made a fertile ground for players to start suggesting things associated with that that made the game deeper. The briefcase is another example of this, and is perhaps even more intense. The ambassador has a briefcase. The original mission that I will eventually get to is to steal nuclear plans from the briefcase, you know, traditional spy movie trope. But in order to do that, I had to put a briefcase in the game, and the ambassador is a very forgetful person, and they put their briefcase down and walk away, and so the NPCs come over and pick up the briefcase and go hand it back to the ambassador, because they're all very conscientious. But the etiquette associated with how to do the briefcase, when you chase the ambassador with the briefcase, how far away from the ambassador you have to, the briefcase has to be before an NPC will pick it up, when the ambassador is available to take the briefcase back, created this entire landscape of mechanics that were just totally unintended. The fingerprint, the drink thing, is actually fingerprint the ambassador across a whole range of different mission sites. So we didn't play with this as well. To the point where, this is a four-page, really in-depth document called the Complete Briefcase Guide, which at the end it's like not even complete, that players wrote for briefcase etiquette, how not to get shot dealing with the briefcase. So basically, the rule of thumb is don't ever pick up the briefcase until you actually read this doc and know what you're doing, and even then, really think twice about picking up the briefcase. None of this was intended. All of this was me seeing the behavior of the players and lucking out that the ground was fertile enough in this game that this kind of thing can happen. Another example is it has to do with contacting the double agent. So one of the missions is you say a secret code word, which happens to be banana bread for silly reasons involving me eating banana bread when I was programming the mission. But this is how you contact a double agent. You have to begin a conversation. So go and then you say it's banana bread. Both players can hear it, so it's a deductive mechanic. The sniper knows someone in a conversation group had to have said it and they hear it. And that allows them to eliminate suspects who are out of conversation. Right? So there's trade-offs, and this is what we call a soft tell. You can fake contact a double agent. You can say the contact phrase, banana bread, outside of conversation. You still have to be in a conversation. You can say it when the double agent is not in a conversation, right? Because I needed to make sure that when I was first implementing this, I put faking in because I wanted to make sure that the sniper couldn't. If you could only really contact a double agent when you were in a conversation with the actual double agent, that means that where the sniper can see who the double agent is, roughly. That means anybody outside of that is eliminated from suspicion. So I need to make it possible for the spy to fake the contact. And then, like the briefcase and the drinks, all this stuff just started happening. So initially, people people spam the contact phrase because it's funny to hear me say banana bread over the speakers, and it rattles newbie snipers, right? They're like, oh no, it's another banana bread, what's going on? And you'll hear five or six of them in a row in very early game. Soon they realize that that actually is just giving away information. Anybody not in a conversation can just get eliminated from suspicion. And they slowly stop doing that. And I thought, for the longest time, and actually it was true, for the longest time, faking was never a good strategy. It was only a beginner kind of, it was kind of a newbie trap. It was just like, and not trap is not the right word, because I wasn't trying to be malicious and make people do this. I was just providing the option. But then people, elite players, started doing it to cover for other missions. So if you fake contact, and you can't tell as a sniper whether it's a real contact or a fake, if you fake contact the double agent, the sniper usually is going to go around lowlighting everyone, you know, marking everyone not suspicious outside of a conversation. So what elite players started doing is fire off fake contact and then do a bug ambassador or one of the other cartel missions. Then knowing, because they can also see the laser where the sniper is looking, then knowing that the sniper is now busy doing other stuff. None of this was intended. This is all just what happens when you create this situation, you know, a fertile enough ground for this kind of thing to happen. So, and then it just keeps looping, like, then it becomes, then now, then it went to a phase where whenever you hear a contact, you don't look for low lights, you look for hard tells. So, of course, this Yomi thing happens where, you know, the meta evolves like that, none of which was designed in on purpose. Like, a lot of this was just, okay, let me just do what seems plausible here for a cocktail party game. Trying to be conscientious about the fact that it's a spy game and keep things on theme, but I just definitely did not foresee this like fifth level Yomi thing going on with some of this stuff. And so these three or four examples are slightly different from the exploit embrace thing. These are basically like amplified unintended design. So like when something, recognizing when a mechanic turns out to be richer than you thought it was going to be, which seems to be working better, or at least has a feeling that it going in this direction would like there's a hint of something deeper that you didn't foresee, I decided, okay, I'm going to double down and push this even further. Whether it was a player suggested way of pushing it further, like the fingerprint or purloin missions, or whether it was things like things that I noticed just by watching people play. But again, it's about being open and willing to change your game based on what's happening, kind of reactive in that sense. Another example of this is the balcony map. This is a different kind of example. So Spy Party is a pretty tense game to play. It's pretty stressful, and people play, even the elite players, like, you know, they'll play an hour or so match with, you know, 10 or 20 games, and then you need to take a break, because you're just, it's so intense, you're so, as the spy, you're so under the gun all the time, literally, and as the sniper, you're so intently focusing, that the game's pretty stressful. And so when I did a new set of maps one time, I was like, I want to make a game, I want to make a venue that's a little bit more arcade, something you don't have to worry about too much, you've got to play casually. And so I made this tiny little map called Balcony. It has one conversation circle and just a couple, you know, places to stand. And I was like, okay, this will be arcade mode, there's not a lot to do, there's no books or statues or any of this other stuff going on. It'll just be a light version, you can kind of do it and you can play, it's only 2 minutes long, you can just go play a bunch of rounds and not worry about it. And it started out like that, but it now is the most intense, stressful map. Because what happened was, because the sniper can see everything at the same time and there's only a few different missions that you can accomplish, it allows the sniper to just completely focus on all the etiquette stuff and all the deeper behavioral stuff, where the spy has to get everything right. So instead of this becoming an arcade mode map, it now is like the kind of the most immense psychological map. It's kind of the most of if you break things up into hard tells and soft tells, where hard tells are animation breaks and things like that, and soft tells are just like who's acting strangely, you know, who, what kinds of things I can do that are not precise clues about who the character is. This is the most intense map for that. So that's an example of allowing for direction change. Like this is literally 180 the direction I was trying to go, and so I could have tried to fix the map, quote unquote. I could have tried to figure out what was making it intense and like remove that stuff and keep an arcade mode thing. Or I can double down and say, okay, this is actually working in a way that's consonant with the theme of the game. It just is totally different from what I was expecting to the situation. And so I think that there's three basic requirements for for being able to take advantage of this kind of stuff happening in your game. And I'm talking about E20 in turn. They're cultivating an open mind, feedback, and serendipity. They're all pretty obvious. And I'll just talk a little bit more about them, so the details. They're setting aside real actual wall clock calendar time for sitting their game. And they're farming for a while. So for the first one, I don't know if this is unique to me or not, but I used to be really bad at accepting feedback for my stuff. I was like, you know, the 20-year-old hotshot guy. I could program really well. I was like, all right, I got my ideas. I just need to get these ideas through as unscathed as possible from all these users, like, you know, having opinions about what I'm doing. And so that turns out not a very effective way to go through life. And actually, it's my friend Ocean Quigley, who's the art director from Spore, a big project I worked on at EA, who kind of caught me doing this. On Spore, I worked on the creature animation system for Spore, which is a pretty complicated, crazy, big 100-person team game. And he gave me some advice that has stuck with me ever since, and it completely changed my opinion about feedback and how I kind of integrate with feedback. And I mean, by feedback, I mean both feedback from other people, like playtests or players, and also, you know, if the game is giving me feedback in the luck sense and the serendipity sense. And what he said was that if you have a strong internal compass, and what I mean by that is you know what you're trying to do. You know, you have an aesthetic goal for your game. This is another reason why this is kind of more compatible with indie games than it is with a AAA game, because it's really hard for individuals on a AAA team to have kind of an aesthetic goal for the game and actually implement that. But as an indie, that's kind of what your job is, to actually pull true to this. If you've got this internal compass, and it doesn't mean you never change direction, but it means that you've got, at any given time, you've got a way of judging whether things are kind of consonant with the game or dissonant with the game. If you've got this, then ideas are, if someone giving you feedback or ideas is free ideas, why wouldn't you take them? Like, it doesn't mean you have to implement them. It's like, hey, have them, you know, they might be better ideas that actually make the game you're trying to make better. And if they're not, then you just like, you know, listen to the idea. It's like, oh, yeah, okay, thanks for the idea. And then just, you know, not implement it. There's no cost. And I had tied my own ego up so much in whether or not I was accepting feedback from people that I didn't realize this is actually an amazing resource. So now I'm like, ever since then, this is, I don't know, whatever score was 15 years ago. Ever since then, like, I love feedback. Like, the more feedback, the better. It doesn't mean I have to change the game. It means that it's like, you know, like I said, in Spy Party, multiple missions, multiple venues, multiple characters have been suggested by the community, and they all make the game better. The idea is that, you know, there's on the forums, there's a multi-hundred page suggestion thread. And there's tons of ideas in there that are not in line with the game I'm trying to make, and I just want to implement those. But the fact that I've got this font of ideas that players want to contribute this stuff, or I notice things on a stream when someone's playing it, I'm like, oh, wow, I should double down on that the way I was talking about before. That's huge, and I really, maybe I was the only person who had this problem, but if you have any inkling of that kind of, like, resistant to feedback thing, I encourage you, especially if you want to, like, take advantage of this luck idea, this idea of listening to the game, I encourage you to flip that 180 and realize that it's not a threat. The second thing is setting aside real calendar time for being with your game, kind of sitting with your game. Now, Spy Party has been developed for 9 years, which is like an embarrassingly long amount of time, and I'm not saying you need to actually be in development for 9 years to take advantage of this, but you do need to have time to notice some of this stuff, like the drinks, stuff I talked about earlier, the content of Double Agent stuff, that stuff took months and sometimes years to develop that meta so that I could see where it was going. If you're on a schedule, especially a design style schedule, if you're on a schedule and you're trying to get the thing done and it makes you less open-minded to seeing, to notice that these things happen, it's kind of like that. The Washington Post did a really interesting experiment in the Washington, D.C. subway system one time. There's a famous classical violinist named Joshua Bell. And he has a Stradivarius, and he plays sold out concert halls. He's, you know, a pinnacle classical violinist. And they had him busking with his Stradivarius, actually, in the Washington, D.C. subway system. Just another random musician player in the subway that you see as you walk by. And they wanted to see how many people would notice this and stop. Because literally the night before, he had played a $350 ticket concert. And very few people, everyone totally obvious that very few people would stop. But if you're not taking time, you're going to miss a lot of things, and I think that's true with music especially. Things take time to simmer. You need to be in the shower that one day when you have the idea, or you see the screen because somebody picked it up. This is super important. So, and I know this is really hard. I'm super privileged that I was able to work on Spy Party for so long, and still am. And I know not everyone has that that opportunity. But take as long as you can. Get your game out there and get people playing your game as much as you can early, so that you have time to see some of this stuff happen, so you can actually have time to listen to what's happening. And then the final one is the least developed of these ideas, and I'm not sure exactly I'm not sure exactly how to describe this one. Basically, the idea is you want to be working in fertile ground. You want to be working in a game design space where this kind of thing can happen, where when you put something in, like a drink mechanic, a lot of stuff sprouts around that. I find that incredibly important. Now, I happen to look into a design where there's just not a lot of games about normal people in the world hanging out. And so every single thing I put in this game, basically, has this characteristic of stuff just springs out around and people have ideas based on their experience at a party or their experience seeing some spy fiction or whatever. Not all game designs can be quite as open-ended and blue ocean, as they say, as doing something completely new. You can have derivative work, and that's fine, and there are some really great games that are similar. But the more you can do this, the better. If you're doing a game about big dudes with axes beating up on orcs, you're in much more explored territory, right? And so you're less likely to have the opportunity for these kinds of things, these random events, to happen. To get away from Spy Party for the last bit here, I think the Zachtronics games are another example. I look for games that have this kind of fertile ground feel. And one thing that's really interesting about it, if you're familiar with Zachtronics games, that I think qualifies for this fertile ground thing, is that the puzzles themselves, these games are like programming games, basically. If you're trying to build this thing that accomplishes the task. And much like programming, you can do a really bad job of it and still get a giant game done, right? You still get the puzzle done, finish the task done. The challenge comes not in actually just accomplishing, checking the box. The challenge comes in doing it elegantly or fast or better than your friends. It has the same kind of property of like, you can kind of throw almost any puzzle in there because getting the puzzle done is only the first step in actually the richness of the game, of iterating, making the thing better, competing with your friends. Opus Magnum has this amazing thing where auto-generates a GIF that you can like post on Twitter or Facebook that showing your solutions, you can fight with your friends like in social media. Like, there's just a lot of stuff going on in these games that a lot of conferences wrote an article about this in Rocket Pachaka, actually. There's a lot of things about the way this game, the kind of place he decides to make games that have this fertile ground thing that I'm talking about. And so I wanted to say it's not just Spy Party. I see this in a lot of different places. So I would like to encourage you to try and farm. So I think that's it. And so thank you, and I take questions, and good luck.
Yeah, 지금까지 Walk and Listening in Game Design이라는 발표로 강연해 주신 Definition 6의 Chris Hecker님 대표의 말씀을 잘 들었습니다. 다시 한번 큰 박수 부탁드립니다. 네, 지금 시간이 한 2, 3분 정도 남았는데요. 저희가 이제 쉬는 시간에도 뭐 각자 만나서 Q&A 뭐 시간을 가질 수도 있는데 약간 시간이 남은 관계로 질문을 하나 받도록 하겠습니다. 저기 마이크 하나 전달 부탁드리겠습니다.
Do you think the deepness that both of your games happen to have is basically because you are trying to model something that is actually true to real life, and real life is really complex? So that's one way to think about it.
So I think no is the answer. So the question is that fertile ground? That might be. So is the fertile ground coming from the fact that you're trying to simulate something that's happening in the real world, the kind of thing that actually exists? And maybe that actually is a way of. I think that might be sufficient, but not necessary, because the other example that I cut, just for time reasons, was the another that I'm familiar with is the witness puzzle structure, the panel puzzles in the game, the witness, which actually Casey might. Those are fertile ground, and they're really a completely abstract puzzle situation. So he chose, John Blow, the designer of that game, early on chose this grid-based thing where the line you were drawing on this grid, trying to pass through a certain number of points, there's a bunch of different, get to an endpoint, couldn't cross over itself. And that turned into a really good constraint and made it a more fertile ground for exploring stuff there. So by picking constraints even in that, which is almost as abstract as you can get as far as that is what I would consider a fertile ground. He basically like couldn't implement all the puzzles that sprung out of all the different mechanics that he had there. So I think that like maybe modeling the real world has complexities too that you don't want to model. Like Spy Party, early on I thought Spy Party was going to be much more simulation-y. And Frank Lance, who's the head of NYU's Game Center, came up with this term that I really liked. It's the way that I had it in the initial implementation, which is kind of rough and like, you know, the AI was like, you know, the way he called it a clockwork party. And you know, so like the whole thing is like you can kind of see the gears in Spy Party turning. And that actually turns out to be there might be another game that kind of much softer simulation of real world cocktail parties. Because in the real world cocktail party, your flotation is not filling a bar from 0 to 100%, right? Like that's an incredibly abstract, an abstraction of an actual kind of thing that thematically echoes in your head. You're like, oh, now I'm flirting with this person. But I mean, in reality, pushing a button, depending on how close you are, fills a bar, right? But that clockwork party turns out to work really well for Spy Party, another lucky thing, where because of the clockwork party, it's kind of because the innards are kind of exposed, it allows the players to kind of have a set of firm rules that they can then work with it. Right? Whereas it's a much softer kind of like lots of floating point numbers going up and down kind of simulation thing, you never know really where you stood. There might be a game there. And originally I thought that was the game I was making, but that's another perfect example. Early on, the clockwork party started working. That idea of this really kind of like almost rigid robotic thing. And one of the characteristics of the Spy Party that turned out to be bear a lot of fruit was this idea of the reverse Turing test. Instead of the AI trying to pretend like a human, the human trying to pretend like an AI. And it's much easier for a human to emulate a broken AI than it is for a broken AI to emulate a human. So that's something that turned out to work really well in this fertile ground thing as well. But I think that, like, I wouldn't want to encourage people to try and quote unquote simulate the real world. I think you have to abstract it, especially in games. Like, I mean, but I don't think it's necessary. I think that could lead to ways, especially thematically, your brain can help with that kind of thing. But I don't think it's necessary. That was a long answer to your short question.
Thank you very much.